Karen wants to know what her rights are as a landlord. We have no pre-occupation, no pre-occupation inspection form, she says, but have obvious damage to our property. Can I take this off the deposit? And she wants to know, is the situation any different if an inspection was done, but no notes were made on the pre-occupation form, as compared to no inspection having been done at all?
Truth is, well, all the joyful truth, it depends on which side of the conversation you sit. The Rental Housing Act specifically require us to do an incoming and exit inspection. And the purpose of this inspection is very clear in terms of the Act. The Act wants us to record the condition of the property and any defects to the property. And the purpose of the recordal of the defects is to demonstrate that these defects were in the property, so the paint were chipped or the window was broken or whatever the case might be, prior to the tenant taking occupation. Meaning that when the tenant vacates the premises, the landlord can't hold the tenant liable for normal fair wear and tear. And the only thing that the landlord can hold the tenant responsible for is actual damage to the property. Now, the problem that I'm seeing very often is people do a very quick entry inspection and they or none at all. The problem is what the Act then says is if there is no inspection or no recordal of defects, it's deemed that everything was fine, but now we can't prove where the problem is. So if you have, say for instance, some fair wear and tear problems, for instance, paint that starts fading over time, it's sort of obvious to see, okay, these the paint here is faded. It's not like painting over it by kids or something like that. This is a fair wear and tear type of problem, which is landlord's responsibility. The problem is, if a landlord can't prove that there wasn't any damage to something in the property, even though it's deemed then to be all in order and any damage that was caused might have been caused by the tenant, unless you can show as a landlord that this window was actually in good order and it wasn't broken, it wasn't cracked, if you can't prove that the damage was in fact caused by the tenant, you sit with a massive issue. The Act is actually quite simple and says all the landlord has to do is when you can show there wasn't a defect to the property. Now on your exit inspection, there is a defect. The only thing a landlord has to do is to show the receipt of the repairs to the tenant. So why this is pleasant is you don't have to go through all the effort of getting multiple quotes. You can just fix it and deduct it from the deposit. The problem is, if you are a landlord and you didn't do an incoming inspection, or you did an incoming inspection and you did not just record the defects and the actual true condition of the property, you can't demonstrate that these defects were in fact caused by the tenant, you're left in a position where you're going to have to show actually that these defects were caused by the tenant. And the truth is very often the process of showing that is so time consuming and costly that it almost makes no sense. So unfortunately, in most instances where you didn't do a full complete entry inspection and recorded not only the defects but also the true condition of the property, my advice is always take photos not just of a room. Take proper photos of every wall, of every window, of every door, of every handle. So you can actually show this door handle was lacquer at the time of the tenant taking occupation and now there's no door handle left. It's very easy for a landlord to demonstrate that this damage was obviously caused by the tenant. If you have is slightly quickly done. Entry inspection, and you're like, everything is fine. But there's this one cracked window. Okay, that is unlikely. And you can't easily demonstrate that there was no other defects to the premises. So it's a very tricky situation. So the truth about entry and exit inspections is, unless they are done thoroughly, like every room, room by room, item for item recorded, it was in order, now it is no longer. You are going to have an uphill battle trying to collect that money from the deposit. However, the good news is, if you do it correctly, if you actually record, this is the living room, everything is fine, there's a bit of a paint problem there, that window has a slight crack in it, everything else is perfect, and you have photos. It's as simple as when the tenant vacates the premises and you do your exit inspection and you see, oh my goodness, now you have an issue with paint that's not the way it should be, windows are cracked, whatever the case might be. It's as simple as providing the tenant with the receipts of their repairs, deduct it from the deposit, and it's as simple as that. So unfortunately, if you do not have proper entry and exit inspections, you are going to have an uphill battle on collecting it. And honestly, I would be reluctant to advise anybody to simply deduct money from a deposit unless they can properly show that this damage was in fact caused by the tenant. Otherwise, you might run into quite a few problems.
Well, thank you so much, Cilna. I think the bottom line there, like you're saying, reiterating, is record. Just do everything you can to jot all the information down so you never run into problems again. Thank you for
and
that,
Cilna. Photos.
Yes.
Photos with reference, definitely.
Thanks, Cilna. Right. So here goes. Here's the next question. Zita says she had a huge disagreement about the legality of a particular matter with someone who indicated to her that there was a company that manages to register a tenant's rent and electricity all on one bill. She was informed by this person that when the tenants default on their rent, their electricity can be cut off. She says this person told her of two cases which were settled in this manner. She wants to know if this is true and if it's legal. Bruno, what can we say to Zita here quickly?
Yeah, no. there's a lot of, there are many, many creative things that landlords have come up with to try and force people into a position where they're forced to pay rent or forced to pay their arrears. But the rule of thumb is electricity, you pay for electricity. It's a specific payment. It gets allocated towards that. And by virtue of being allocated towards that, it can't just be disconnected. There's very special rules around disconnections, and anyone but the municipality doing it would require a court order before being able to do it, which is why we constantly advise just get prepaid meters, guys. It's really the easiest thing to do. But even with prepaid meters, the problem obviously is that the tenants start paying the water and lights because they don't want to be disconnected, but they fall into heavy arrears with respect to their rentals. So some creative landlords then try to load rentals on the prepaid meters so that it's one bulk sum that you need to pay in full before you actually get electricity. And this doesn't fly in practice because the problem is one's not connected to the other. It's a different service that's being provided. So the only arguments that made sense a while ago was how you allocate a payment that comes into your account, what do you allocate it first towards. But, you know, again, you can't just go around switching off electricity. And once you have prepaid meters, that's specific for electricity. So the long and short of it is no. I've seen a lot of ways that come close to working, but that's very specialized. And it's not, like I told Cilna before, I mean, this is when I'm working with my industrial clients and my commercial clients that have different ways of running businesses and different structures. So short of that, when it comes to residential, it's a big no on my side.
Cool. Cilna, I'm going to throw this quickly over to you. What can we do, very quick fire, if you are the victim of this kind of situation where your electricity is terminated in this fashion?
Oh, that's a nice question. A spoliation application to any court. And if you feel like doing it yourself, you can go to any magistrate court and you can say to the clerk of the court, hey, somebody's disconnected my electricity supplies. I've been locked out, whatever the case might be. And most magistrate courts have standard forms that you can complete to bring a spoliation application. And if you don't feel like doing that, you can appoint an attorney, bring the application in the High Court. That's quite easy and quick to do as well. And also the Rental Housing Tribunal. So if it's a residential property, the Rental Housing Tribunal does have a jurisdiction to hear if spoliation applications on an urgent basis. You'll be in court basically. In a court, you'll probably be in Match Court, you'll be in court in about 2 to 3 days. High Court, depending on the situation, you can be in court. If we bring the application right now, you can be in court by about 10 tonight. If you can type quickly, you can be in court that quick. And tribunal, you'll be in court in about also 3 to 4 days from bringing the application. So it's definitely doable. Try to avoid the police. It's a civil matter, so the police is going to be like, what? So that might not really help too much, but you can go to any court or the Rental Housing Tribunal.
Thank you so much, Cilna. I'm actually quite impressed with you guys. That was very quick fire.